In for our worship service this morning. We want to welcome you to our worship this morning here at Countryside. And as you make your way in, please make sure you do grab the elements for communion on the back table. Also for those joining us from the overflow room, we want to thank you for joining us there, but also there are elements on the back table there as well. And as you make your way in, please do try to scrunch together as much as possible to make room for those who are still coming in. Especially with the altered parking for this week. Please stand with me this morning as we prepare to worship the Lord. Colossians 3, 16 and 17 says this, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in all wisdom, singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with thankfulness in your hearts to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." Let's praise him together this morning.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glory. Power of God that makes the mountains rise, that spread the flowing seas abroad. lofty skies. I sing the wisdom that ordained the sun to rule the day. The moon shines full at his command, and all the stars
go ahead and be seated. This morning, as we come to celebrate communion, we want to make sure that you guys grab the elements from the back table. So if you haven't already done that, please go ahead and make your way on back to grab those in the back of the auditorium and for those in the back of the overflow. And this morning, I want to invite everyone who's a believer in Jesus Christ to participate in remembering the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we invite everyone who's a believer, whether you're a member of this church or another, but as long as you're trusting alone in the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, we invite you to participate this morning. If you're not trusting in him or are under church discipline at this church or another, we do ask that you refrain from partaking in the elements this morning. Instead, watch the gospel before us as we recount who Christ is and the sacrifice he has done on behalf of sinners like me and you. Don't take the communion elements because everyone else is. Rather, reflect on where you are before Jesus Christ. It is important. Don't do this in fear of man. Do this in fear of God. As a believer, that's a rejoicing because of what he's covered for us. And as a non-believer or one who is questioning, reflect on what joy could be had in Christ as we reflect on who he is this morning. This morning, let's take a moment and quiet our hearts. Before we take the elements this morning, let's get honest before God about where you are before him and reflect on who he is. And let's make sure we are examining our hearts that we are worthy of the sacrifice and remembering the sacrifice this morning. So let's quiet our hearts. Amen. Well, as we consider this morning, I got to thinking about something unique in my life right now, and that is the blessing of being a parent. And when Lauren, when God saw fit to bless Laura and I with children and become parents, the excitement that we had was inexpressible, yet daunting. With each doctor's visit that we went to, it was an exciting moment to see the transformation process happen from each visit, and the way it came from a blip on a screen of a human to me to a functioning human baby that it changed in, week out. The development of fingers and organs and breathing just was an amazing transformation process to watch and be a part of. We even had an app that showed what formed that week and about where the baby was, and it was so exciting to see the development of each child that God brought to us. And each child transformed before our eyes in so many different aspects, from something unrecognizable to a beautiful baby. But while that transformation process is one of the most exciting ones to be a part of, there's another transformation process that is unparalleled in our lives, and especially in for the believer. And that is the process of salvation, the transforming power of the gospel. And the process begins with a good, perfect, holy, and righteous God who can have no part of sin, that looked upon a sinful and hopeless man. He willingly took on sin that all men have committed upon himself. 2 Corinthians 4:21 says this: "For our sake he made him, Christ, to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." He provided a way for us to be righteous before him. In his mercy and love, God provided his Son to die in our place for the sin that we are liable for. Romans 5:8 says this: "But God shows his love for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Christ accomplished a feat that no other has ever done in history. He conquered sin once and for all, and for all, which delivers the sinner from the domain of sin into his kingdom of glorious light. Colossians 1:13-14 says this: "He has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins." It was not earned by us, this deliverance from sin. In his grace, while we were actively working against him for our own purposes, he completed the act of atonement. Colossians 1:21-22 says this: "And you who were once alienated and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he, Christ, has now reconciled in his body of flesh by his death, in order to present you holy and blameless and above reproach before him." God transforms, he changes the dead sinner into a marvelous new creation in an instant, and is the most beautiful process to witness in this life. And the process is most clearly seen in Ephesians 2:1-7. Says this: "And you were dead in your trespasses and sin, in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. We can be eternally grateful for the change, the transformation that God makes in the believer that was accomplished through his grace and his sacrifice on the cross. And as we consider this wonderful transformation process, we want to be celebrating and remembering him through the elements represented this morning. So let's go ahead and open up our elements this morning. And as we're doing that, I'd like to ask one of our deacons. Yeah, sorry, you changed it on me. I went blank. Nope, not it. It's not it. Mike Hoskins, thank you. Mike Hoskins, to pray for us this morning.
We thank you, Lord, for the but God verse, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that while we were sinners, you died for us. While we were enemies, Lord, Lord, you pleased God in our behalf. Lord, we were making you angry, Lord, and he, Lord, propitiated for our sins. Thank you, Lord, that we just repent and believe, Lord, and trust you, and that you wipe that all away. We thank you for your body and your blood. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Scripture says that he took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's remember him this morning. Let's eat together. And I'd like to ask one of our other deacons, Andrew Rogal, to pray for the juice this morning.
Dear Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your grace, and we are blown away by the incredible cost that it took to obtain that grace. Thank you, Lord, for providing for us so richly and so abundantly in a way that was so costly for you. Pray, Lord, that we remember that with hearts of gratitude this morning.
All right, Scripture says, in the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the cup in the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me." Let's drink together this morning. Please stand with us as we sing to our glorious God this morning.
This is the power of our need, for we are broken and weak. Who is the gift of God to be the source of life, hope and peace? Jesus, the great I am. Jesus, the
pray together. Father, we are enraptured with Jesus, the Savior, our Redeemer, our brother, our Lord. Father, right now our hearts need to hear from you. They need your word to interact with our thoughts, with our emotions, and with our wills, so that we might become the people of God who reflect their Father and their Savior, Jesus. And we pray this in Jesus' great and glorious name. Amen. You may be seated. It's good to be with you this morning. You know, Brian did this a few weeks ago. He introduced himself, and it's been a while since I've thought about that, but there are a large number of you who probably don't know who I am. My name is Otto Skoog. I am one of the pastors on staff here at Countryside, and if I haven't met you yet, I look forward to meeting you. It's a great joy and privilege to bring God's Word to you this morning. Before I do that, I'd like to thank those of you who have been praying for my father-in-law, Eldon Crenshaw, who had a stroke last Friday and is on the road to recovery. I will say this last week for me has been a very interesting week with God. Not interesting like I was upset with God, but interesting in terms of evaluating my own frailty before God. Eldon's one of the stronger guys I know. No, not muscly. No, not manly out there carting deer. He's killed with his bare hands out of the wilderness. That not that kind of thing, but the kind of guy who, you know, slalom skied when he was 60, water skied when he was 60, you know, rode 70 miles on his bike when he was 70, and he's not a long distance bike rider. Just one of those people that I admired and saw his strength, right? And now that strength has been lost to the curse of this fallen world. And watching him suffer to the glory of God has been really humbling. I understand Paul's words to the church at Philippi when he said that through their prayers, he would be delivered, not set out of prison, but delivered, vindicated, that Christ would be honored in his body, whether by life or by death. And I've been witnessing that in the last week. As a man, a strong man, lays there honoring Christ, not shaking his fist at God, but eager and anxious to see what God will do through this time. And I appreciate your prayers. That's what Paul said. That your prayers, church at Philippi, were a part of that. Your prayers, Countryside, have come alongside my father-in-law and enabled him to bring glory to God in this time, and I appreciate that. All right. Last Sunday, Kansas City won its second Super Bowl in 4 years. Let's bring a little levity to the heaviness, right? After the game, my family and I were talking, and my wife asked if there might be a big letdown for the winner after something like this. You know, after all the adulation and the celebration. And, you know, I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure in the context of one game. I hadn't heard anybody talk about it specifically in terms of the context of one game, but I have heard ex-players talk about how hard it is after they have retired from the game. They miss the camaraderie of the locker room. They miss the crowds at the stadium. They miss the thrill of the game and the cheers of the fans. Some, after retirement, even struggle with depression for a time. Because that admiration, that praise is hard to replace. For many, they go from being a somebody to being an anybody. And that's a difficult transition. The cheers are hard to forget because it's easy to get caught up in praise. You know, that can be true for the people of God as well. It's easy for anyone to begin living for praise. In fact, it's possible to live for God in a way that is not for God, but for yourself. Did you hear that? It's possible to live for God in a way that is not for God, but for yourself. Find your way in your preferred Bible to Matthew chapter 6. We'll be looking at verses 1 through 4 this morning. Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. Our theme for the book of Matthew is this: because Jesus is the Messiah King, we must worship and follow Him. Because Jesus is the Messiah King, we must worship and follow Him. And that can be turned into a question for all of us this morning. Am I a worshiper of Jesus? And am I following Him? In our passage today, Jesus continues His expose on the heart. And in the section we are beginning today, which runs through verse 18, He takes aim at three prominent religious practices: giving to the poor, prayer, and fasting. All three of these were important demonstrations of piety or commitment to God. And as Jesus reveals, all three can be turned from selfless acts in the worship of God to prideful acts in the worship of self. And the key difference between the two is the heart motive behind the act of worship. So follow along as I read Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. Beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. For then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. Thus, when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Last week, I sat down with Pastor Michael to talk about this passage and the ones which follow it. And as we batted around a theme for this passage, he suggested this, and I think it's the right one. Here it is. You are either practicing your righteousness to receive the praise of others or to bring glory to God. You are either practicing your righteousness to receive the praise of others or to bring glory to God. And with that theme in mind, there are three implications from this passage that I want to draw your attention to this morning. And the first is this: God cares about the heart behind your righteous deeds. God cares about the heart behind your righteous deeds. Look back at verse 1. Jesus' preaching has been prying open the hearts of the people and exposing the sin that remains hidden within. The heart has always been the target for God. You may know Proverbs 4:23, keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. But tension arises when we try to keep our heart, doesn't it? Consistently, since the beginning, God has wanted His people to see that something is fundamentally wrong on the inside, and that they are in desperate need of spiritual transformation. This is why Jesus' teaching on this is so powerful. Jesus' teaching highlights that the outside can appear to conform to the law of God, and yet the core of the person is still completely rotten. Now you can see this if you remember what Jesus said in Matthew 5:20. He said, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, this saying was meant to be arresting for both the religious leaders and the people. The religious leaders appeared to be the most strident followers of the Mosaic law, and Jesus had just said that they were not righteous enough. So what more could be done? Does that mean there is no kingdom hope for the average Joe or Joseph? And then Jesus revealed that he wasn't talking about more religious deeds or more ostentatious acts of righteousness. Everybody trying to outdo one another, looking righteous. What he revealed through the words that followed this statement was the idea that what goes on the inside of a person is just as important is what happens on the outside. I think most of us would agree that when something looks bad on the outside, there's probably a correlation to something bad on the inside. But what Jesus has been revealing to us is that there are times when everything looks right on the outside, but the inside is not right. The man or woman appears to be righteous or obedient to God, but on the inside there is sin run amok. And in our passage today, Jesus continues to drive home this point. He begins with the word beware. Look back at that verse. Beware. Be on guard. Be alert. Look out. Look out for this to see if it's in your own life. Consider whether what I'm about to say is true of you. And if so, be warned. Beware. Now, his warning follows the exhortation in the previous section to be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now, a natural tendency for any person hearing this sermon, hearing those last words, might be to seek an external affirmation that we are doing just that, that we are looking just right, that we are hitting the standard, measuring up to the mark. Some hearing this may have considered those they observed to already be living to this lofty goal. But again, what Jesus wants to stress is that the external behavior that the people who are listening to him or that the people in this room might be exhibiting may not accurately reflect the motive of the heart. And so at the end of the day, the heart, as Brian told us several weeks ago, is what truly matters. This has always been the problem. Isaiah 29:13. In this verse, God made this analysis of his people. This people draw near to me with their mouth. They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Everything sounds good, God says. But I can see who they truly are. Everything looks good, God says. But I know them at the core of their being. Beware, Jesus said. Don't let your righteousness become motivated by the affirmation of others. Instead of seeking the approval of others, seek the approval of God. Now, hearing this, you might be confused because of what Jesus said in Matthew 5, verse 16. In the same way, he said, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. at Jesus. Those two don't make sense together. They do. These two sayings of Jesus are not in conflict. Our lives are meant to be lived before the watching world. Our lives should reflect the character of God to the world around us. We want to be imitators of our Heavenly Father, as we heard last week. And we want to be people who experience His grace through us. Look again at 5:16. I'll wait for Joe to put it up there for you. What is the motive behind the way we are to live? It is that others would give glory to God. That's a different motive than the one Jesus is warning us of in chapter 6, verse 1. You can see that if you look back at chapter 6, verse 1. In 5:16, we want others to see God, not us. In 6:1, the motive is that we want others to see us. To see how gracious we are. To see how holy we are. We want others to glory in us. Beware of this, Jesus warns, because any act of righteousness done with this motive will not be rewarded by the Father. God cares about the heart behind your righteous deeds. The second implication from this passage follows and is found in verse 2. Helping others from the wrong heart motive is of no lasting value to you. Helping others from the wrong heart motive is of no lasting value to you. Verse 2, thus when you give to the needy, sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may be praised by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. Now, this isn't a mini sermon by Jesus on giving. Of the three acts, giving, prayer, and fasting, the only act expanded on by Jesus and recorded by Matthew is in relationship to prayer. And possibly that's because what we pray reveals as much about the heart as anything. But in our passage, Jesus just assumes that giving to the poor is happening, because it was a regular part of first century Jewish observance. In the law, God had not commanded a particular tithe or a particular offering that should be given for the poor and needy. There are passages that speak about special times every 3 years or every 6 years where the poor are cared for through special circumstances. And there were general reminders that the poor in Israel were to be cared for by the people, like this one in Deuteronomy 15:11, for there will never cease to be poor in the land. Therefore, I command you, you shall open wide your hand to your brother, to the needy, and to the poor in your land. Where the curse of Genesis 3 abounds, there will always be those with fewer resources than others, even among God's people in the nation Israel. There's a passage in Proverbs speaking of this type of almsgiving that has a strong connection to verse 4 in our passage. Proverbs 19:17 says, whoever is generous to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will repay him for his deed. Even the Apostle Paul expressed his commitment to this idea in Galatians 2:10, where he writes, only they asked us to remember the poor, the very thing we were eager to do. So Jesus expected giving to the poor to be a part of his listeners' cultural heritage. So he's not preaching about the need to give. He's warning them about the motive behind their giving. His next words have somewhat been lost to the annals of time. Sound no trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets. Is he referring to a real practice? Is he using a special instance of hyperbole to emphasize his point? Is he making a wordplay that connects to the shape of the opening for the offering boxes in his day? Well, the truth is there's no overwhelming evidence to support one interpretation over another. I hope that doesn't bother you. But knowing exactly what these words were referring to isn't important. Because all three possibilities highlight something that was meant to draw attention to the act of giving that was taking place. All three explanations for what Jesus could be referring to here simply point to someone trying to get others to look at them. And Jesus makes that point with his next words, that they may be praised by others. He's saying there's nothing sacrificial here. There's no generosity happening here. There's no giving happening here. Instead, something is being purchased. And that something is praise. That something is approval and admiration. That something is glory for the giver. Now, have you ever been motivated by another's approval? Now, if you said no to that, please consider that you are self-deceived. It's hard for me to imagine a son that doesn't seek his father's approval at one time or another, a daughter who doesn't seek her mother's approval from one time or another. But Jesus isn't saying that all instances of this are wrong. What he's pointing out is that there are times when our service, our worship, and our obedience to God are not motivated by a love for God and for his approval, but they're instead motivated by the impression that we might make on others. Our desire in doing them is to look glorious in the eyes of someone else. Hence the warning by Jesus. He's warning them, as God would warn Israel in Isaiah 48:11, "My glory I will not give to another." The God-man is warning them not to seek the glory that only belongs to God. It's possible, Jesus says, to give your resources, your time, your energy, etc., and be purely selfish in doing it. Now, if that's your motive, then he wants you to know that no matter how generous your gift, God doesn't acknowledge it. That's what he says, isn't it? Right there in verse 2. He doesn't need to. Verse 2 tells us, you have already been rewarded. Already, Jesus says, you got what you wanted, but you won't get what you need. And what you get won't last. But instead will create a hunger for more and more, and ultimately enslave you to the approval of others. And the approval of others is fickle. Just ask those NFL players how much grace they receive when they blow a play or when they get old and their skills begin to diminish. How many cheers are they getting then? God cares about the heart behind your righteous deeds, and helping others from the wrong heart motive is of no lasting value to you. The praise you have received is your reward, and it will fade as quickly as it comes. The third implication from our passage this morning is found in verses 3 and 4, and it's this: helping others from the right heart motive will be rewarded by the Father. Helping others from the right heart motive will be rewarded by the Father. But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Now, it would be easy to take this too literally and to think that all giving must be done anonymously. That you have to set up an account that doesn't have your name on it or doesn't have any way of being traced back to you, or that when you give, you can only give in cash so that no one will know who gave and how much. Now, the figurative language Jesus is using is foreign to us, of course. Do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. But all that means is keep your giving to others between you and God. It's not something that's out there in the open. It's not like you're holding it out and go, hey, take a look left hand, see what's going on there. Hey, Ray, see how much I'm dropping in the offering plate. We don't do that anymore, but, you know, putting in the box in the back. Be like me throwing my iPad up there and letting you see me click, you know, send if I'm giving to some charitable organization or the church. Be like me Instagramming you a video of me delivering, you know, something to somebody's house who is in need. You're like, all of that sounds disgusting. And yet, I bet that if you were truly honest with yourself, you've done many things in the course of your life to impress others with your piety, with your righteousness. That it wasn't a love for God that motivated you. It wasn't a love for others that motivated you. It was simply to be seen and affirmed and approved and admired. Don't look for others' approval or admiration, Jesus said. Instead, give cheerfully as an act of service or worship to God. Protect your heart. If others remark on it, remind them that it is truly God's in the first place and you were simply the conduit. Remind them that you have been blessed to be a blessing. Now you may say, look, it's hard not to feel that sense of pride when others are thankful. And that can be true. That is true. But you know, if we woke up every day with the realization of how truly needy we are, how dependent on God's grace we truly are, our hearts might begin to change. If we looked at others who are not where we are spiritually or materially and thought, but for the grace of God, that's me. That is the honest truth. Where you are spiritually and where you are materially is all due to the grace of God. That's why there is no room for pride. But if we would do that, then our pride would begin to diminish. And as our pride diminishes, our humility would grow. Begin to look out and see the grace of God in your life. And shockingly, our love and compassion for others will begin to grow, and our patience will begin to grow, and our kindness and gentleness will begin to grow. And you get the picture. The fruit of the Spirit will begin to shine everywhere in your life. And that's when Jesus' words about others seeing your good deeds and giving glory to your Father in heaven become real. That's when you will know the reward of the Father. The reward of the Father, the health and wealth gospel preachers would tell you, will be a bigger house and a fancier car and a larger bank account. But what God would say is, I've got a gift that's more valuable than that. And it's the image of my Son, Jesus Christ. And when people see it in you, they will give glory and praise to me because they have never seen anything so valuable in their life. That's what the world needs to see in us. The world needs to see less of us and more of Jesus. And the only way to do that is to wake up every day and pray that God would give us a vision of the power of His grace in our life, and that we would beg Him to become conduits of grace in the lives of other people, and that the fruit of His Spirit would flow through us to them. You know, when people see that, and you tell them about Jesus, they can begin to believe in grace. Could there truly be any greater reward? You don't need others' affirmation. What you need is only the approval of the Father. You are either practicing your righteousness to receive the praise of others or to bring glory to God. God cares about the heart behind your righteous deeds. Helping others from the wrong heart motive is of no lasting value to you, and helping others from the right heart motive will be rewarded by the Father. So where is your heart this morning? Remember the questions that we started with. Am I a worshiper of Jesus? Am I following Him? Think about His words in Matthew 5:20. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. By Jesus' standards, are you good enough to enter the kingdom of heaven? Now, I said by Jesus' standards, not by your wife's standards or your husband's standards or your children's standards or your friend's standards or your neighbor's standards or the comparison that you're making to other people that you know in the workplace, etc. I'm talking about Jesus' standards. Because Jesus said the most righteous people that the people He was talking to knew of in the world were not worthy of the kingdom of heaven. It would be shocking to me if you were worthy because of your good deeds. Absolutely shocking. I'll tell you this, if I had to stand there with my good deeds, there is no way I'm getting into the kingdom of heaven. No way. Even on our best day, our hearts would convict us of sin. And the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. And it is appointed unto man once to die and then to face judgment. You say, well, how do I get a new heart? A man came to Jesus once. Jesus uttered these words to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." You have to be made new to get a new heart. And that new heart only comes with a new Savior. When you stop trying to be a Savior, your own Savior, and you humble yourself as a sinner before the foot of the cross of Jesus Christ, and you confess your need for Him, you not only get a Savior, but you get a new heart. John wrote these words about Jesus. John 3:17, he wrote, "For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through Him." There was no other way for anyone to be saved but that God would send Jesus. Earlier in that same gospel, John would write, "But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." If you want a new heart this morning, humble yourself before God. Admit that you are unrighteous. No matter how good you look on the outside, be honest with God about what is on the inside and plead with God to save you this morning. Plead with God to forgive you of your sin. And my friend, he will. I've been in your shoes, as have all the other followers of Jesus in this room. And we can attest that with that Savior comes a new heart. Give your life to Jesus today. You will not regret it. Pray with me. Father, I thank you for your words, which continue to remind us of our brokenness without Jesus. Father, I thank you that your plan, which is so comprehensive throughout the Bible, is one of heart restoration. Father, I pray that you would impress that upon all of us this morning. For those of us who follow Jesus, Lord, I pray that we would deal with those times when we live righteously before others so that they may praise us. Father, convict us of this sin and strip it away from us. Remove it so that we might reflect you and you alone. And Father, for the one here today who has never been open and honest with you about who they truly are, I pray that you would break them. That you would enable them to see their sin and to see the Savior. And I pray that you would save them this morning as they surrender to you and your will. And I pray this in the glorious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you stand with us as we worship God in song?
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine! I can see all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Thank you.
Amen. I'm going to ask you to be seated, if you will, please. And this morning, it's my privilege to introduce you to